Christ, God the Father, where is your anchor holding this morning? By faith alone, in sight unknown, and yet his eyes were watching me.
The anchor holds, though the ship.
Visions, and I've had dreams, and I've even held them in my hand. But I never knew they would slip right through, like they were only grains of sand.
The anchor holds.
In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11, Paul writes, "For no man can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Christ Jesus." Christ is our solid rock. He is our foundation. Let's stand and sing, "Christ the solid rock I found." As we go to the Lord in prayer this morning, again, there's things on your heart that you can lift to the Lord. I was reading a devotion here the other day, and it talked about prayer, and it says, when you pray to God, you must know what you want. You must know what you want. Jesus said to the blind beggar, "What do you want me to do for you?" And he said, "I want to see." So as we go to prayer, don't just look at it as an exercise. Look at it as something that you go to your Father and you have something specific you want from Him and you ask Him. And then you can ask in confidence. So as we pray, ask in confidence that God's will might be done in our lives. Let's pray. Mighty God, we thank you for being faithful and fulfilling all of your promises to us. You have said that faith comes through hearing your words. Open our ears that we may be attentive to your voice. Help us to listen, but not just listen, respond. Remind us that you are trustworthy. You never fail your children. Lord, increase our faith to know that neither death nor life nor angels or rulers, things present or future, height or depth or anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from your love. Lord, you are our rock and our redeemer. Thank you for being the light of the world, guiding our steps on your path. Your words say that if we trust in you with all of our hearts and do not lean on our own understanding, yielding to you in all our ways, then you will make our path straight. So guide our words, guide our thoughts and our deeds. You are able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or imagine, according to the power that works within your children. And to you be the glory throughout all generations, forever and ever, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Isaiah the prophet wrote in Isaiah 45:22, "Turn to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, For I am God, and there is no other. Let that ring in your head this morning. There is only one God. He is God Jehovah. He is our God. He is the creator of the world. Anything less is not a God. My faith looks up to thee. Let's
good to see all of you here today. Last week, we started looking at giving our very best for this year, the year 2022, to give our very, very best. I sort of challenged you last week that if you're going to do it, this is the year. You don't need to mess around no more. And I'm just going to tell you the way it is. We have messed around and we have messed around, and it's time to quit messing around. It is time to give your very best to the Lord. This is the year. We don't know what this year is going to bring. We don't know the uncertainty that's coming. So this is it, folks. And we're going to continue that thought. We're going to do something today. Hope you brought your seat belt. It may get a little rough before it gets better, but we're going to do what we can. We're going to look at Philippians chapter 4 and verses 1 through 7. Let me read this first. Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. In fact, we're going to stay in this little a letter that Paul had written to the Philippians. We're going to stay right here. We're not going to really go anywhere else. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 1, therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. I beseech Eurydice, and I beseech Synergic, that they be of the same mind in the Lord. apparently two ladies in that church. And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labor with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. How about that? Moderation in verse 5, actually in the Greek, is saying graciousness. Let your graciousness be known unto all men. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Paul had started a lot of churches. We really don't know how many he started during this period of time. We only have what we have in our Bibles. And so we're not really for sure the number that he actually started churches. When I say start a church, I'm talking about starting one from zero. No one, nobody. You know, you go from there. And that's what the Apostle Paul did. Paul started this church, the church at Philippi, and I love the history. If you want to read about it, don't do it now, but later on, you want to read about the starting of the church at Philippi, you'll find it in Acts chapter 16. You remember the story about Lydia? You remember the story about the Philippian jailer? All these guys, they became part of the beginning of the church at Philippi. And it grew and it grew. And we know here that Philippi was his favorite. We all have our favorite churches. I think I probably have my favorite church. And it's not in the south. It's way up north. But that's just the way it is. If you start a church from scratch and you become a part of something like that, it becomes pretty dear to you. But anyway, we know here that Philippi was Paul's favorite church. Why? Well, look at verse 1. In verse 1, he says, what did he say in verse 1? He says, therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved, look at all these wonderful, beautiful, loving, long for, my joy, my crown. I mean, all these words are illustrating the fact that Paul really thought the world of the church at Philippi. Now, there were some people at the church at Philippi that really made the difference. I mean, really, really made the difference. The Apostle Paul was a wonderful preacher, and he was a wonderful church starter. He was a wonderful guy as far as getting things going and trying to help and so forth. But boy, they had some kind of people that was a part of that church. People that they could not do without. Did you know that? People that they could not do without. So I have felt led to talk about this. I want to talk about the people that our church can't do without. And I'm going to stay right in Philippians. There are just some people that pathway can't do without. Think about it. You take away those people from pathway, pathway's in trouble. I don't care what kind of preacher you get. If Billy Graham were living, you get a Billy Graham. I don't care what kind of preacher you get. It takes these type of people that can keep a church strong and keep it going. People our church can't do without. I found every one of them in Philippians. Let's start with number one. The very first thing that we find, this is in Philippians 1:27, the people that our church can't do without. We can't do without the faithful people. Faithful people. Look at verse 27 of chapter 1. Paul said, I want to come to see you, but if I can't, I would hope to maybe hear of your faithfulness. Did you see that in verse 27? I hope that I can hear about your faithfulness, that ye stand fast in one spirit and one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Now, there are other verses, a ton of verses that talks about faithfulness. Well, I've got something to tell you today. Did you know that the Bible, nowhere in the Bible does it commend for greatness, brilliance, and success? You go through your Bible, you will not find in your Bible nowhere that it's going to applaud you for greatness, success, and brilliance. But it will be about faithfulness. The Bible is very clear about this. Very plain. The Bible always commends and applauds for faithfulness. Faithfulness. In Matthew, you know, Jesus taught about the end of the world and the end of time and so forth. And he gave a parable, you know, about the master going away. And he told his servants a few things. And he gave one 5 talents, one 2 talents. I talked about this last week. And one talent. And he came away, and the one with 5 double, and the one with 2 double, and the one with 1, he just bared it. You know, just bared it. Hit it, bared it. And Jesus made this statement to the first two. He said, the master said to them, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant," illustrating the fact that one day, the most glorious thing that you should ever want to hear when you get to heaven is, "Well done, Teddy Ward. Well done." Boy, that'd be worth it all. Is that your desire? You see, I'm not wanting to just make it to heaven. What about you? I am not wanting to just make it to heaven. There are some people that are just wanting to make it to heaven by the skin of their teeth. I'm not that way. I want to make it, and I know I'm going, but I want to hear something from my Savior. What about you? You know, here are two men in a local church. One is a local businessman, very talented. Great Sunday school teacher, sings in the choir, and I'm not talking about our church. This is another church, way off from here, okay? But here are two men in a local church. One is very talented. He's a local businessman, very prominent, sings in the choir. And then there's another guy in that church who is a janitor. He's the janitor. The church pays him to keep it up clean, and he also works for the school. He doesn't really have any talent. But let me tell you about these two guys. The businessman, with all of his talent, with all of his wonderfulness, he would be in church maybe once a month. Yeah, you believe that? Once a month. Loaded with talent, but in church once a month. Here's the janitor. He's in church every week. You could count on him. You could not count on the businessman. With all of his loaded talent, you couldn't count on him, but you could count on the janitor. I ask you, which one would you take for your church? Can I tell you which one I'd like to have as a preacher, a pastor? I'll take the janitor any day. Any day. In 1927, Lou Gehrig, the New York Yankees, outstanding baseball player of the year, 1927, 100 years ago, a long time ago. In his lifetime, he played more consecutive games in history, in the history of the sport. He never missed a game. He was called the Iron Man of baseball. When he died, they made a movie about him, The Pride of the Yankees. What made Lou Gehrig great? Yeah, he had talent. He could do it. But you know what made Lou Gehrig great? It was his faithfulness. He never missed a game. People would say, "Where's Lou Gehrig?" Well, there he is. He's on first base. "Where's Lou Gehrig?" There he is. He's on first base. He never missed a game. That's what made Lou Gehrig so, so great. Y'all, if Jesus were to pick out the most faithful member of Pathway, who would it be? Don't answer. Think about it. If Jesus were to pick out the most faithful member in this church, who would it be? In 1912, the Titanic went down. As the ship was going down, the band played Near My God to Thee. All the members of the band stuck together and played that song as it went under the water. And they went down to their death. In Revelation, Jesus said, "Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life." It's an interesting thing. The Bible teaches about the memory of God. There's two things about the memory of God that you need to know today, and this is what the Bible teaches. The first thing is the Bible teaches that if you confess your sins to Him, He'll never remember your sins again. Never, never, never. If it's brought up ever again, it's of the devil. It's not God's conviction. If you've made it right with God, y'all, it's right. There's a second thing you need to know about the memory of God. He will not remember your sins if you make them right with Him. He'll never remember that again. But He will remember your faithfulness. Isn't that what Jesus said in Revelation? "Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life." Do you ever feel like, "I don't believe the Lord really sees what I'm doing"? Well, I want to tell you, I beg to be different. I beg to differ. He does see what you do. He sees every little faithful moment and work in your life. He'll never forget it. He'll never, never forget your faithfulness. Think about that just for a moment. If everyone was just like you in this church, okay? If everyone were just like you in this church, how many people would we have here Wednesday night? Come on now. This is church. In the Alabama Baptist, I found this article about, and the title of the article was, and I quote, "What is wrong with Mrs. Ella Craig?" and it was stuck in the very back of the paper, which is ridiculous. In my opinion, it should be on the front page. The article said, "What is wrong with Mrs. Ella Craig, 81 years old and never missed Sunday school in 25 years? What is wrong with Mrs. Ella Craig to go to Sunday school and never miss a Sunday for 25 years? Surely she had company on one of those Sunday mornings. Surely she was sick on one of those Sunday mornings. Surely she wanted to make a trip and go on a trip on one of those Sundays. Surely she wanted to sleep late on one of those Sundays. Surely there was bad weather on one of those Sundays. Surely somebody hurt her feelings in those 25 years." And the article concluded, "What is wrong with Mrs. Ella Craig?" And then it said, "There is nothing wrong with Mrs. Ella Craig, but there is something wrong with us." And it's high time that we admit this. You ain't going to get it done unless you're faithful. Number two, the people that our church can't do without would be willing people. In chapter 2, verses 5. Philippians 2, verse 5. "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant." Look at that. He willingly took on the form of a servant, was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man. Look at this. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Jesus was the most willing person ever. Our church cannot do without willing people. There are a lot of willing people in the church today. There are those that are willing to do the work, and there are those who are willing to let you do it. Down through the 50 years of preaching, I've heard people complain about the certain few in the church that runs the church. Now, there are rare cases, okay? But as a whole, the reason that there's a certain few that runs the church, nobody else is wanting to do it. They're the only ones. So watch what you say. When I started out in being a pastor, I started thinking, if I be a good example and just do everything I can do as a pastor or preacher, and if I just be a good example for my people and I do everything, you know what I found out? I thought they would kind of like it and follow my example and pitch in and help and do, you know. That's what I thought. But you know what I found out? I found out there's a lot of churches that are willing to let you kill yourself as a preacher. There's a lot of churches today that have set back, step back, step back, step back, step back, back, let the preacher do it and just let him kill himself, let him burn himself out, let him just get to the point that he's not worth a flip. Shame on us. There's other churches. You find people that are willing to do other work. I love my church, First Baptist Church in Abbeville. It is one of my favorite churches, the First Baptist Church of Abbeville. Some very dear friends there. But it had its downside. You know, it was a county seat church, town, which meant in my church, I had two judges, I had four lawyers, I had one doctor, I had a commissioner, and I had the mayor. And they're my friends. So what I'm about to tell you, I told them to their faces, okay? What really made my butter melt, we would beg people to work in the church. The nominating committee would call and say, please, 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 we need your help. Please, please.
Oh, I can't do it.
But you let the town call. You let the county call. And these folks like to broke their neck. It upset me to no end. Shame on us if we go out here and give our talent and our ability and our time and our faithfulness and work to stuff out there. Don't get me wrong. There's stuff that we need to do, and I support it. I understand that. But it's a shame when we give the leftovers to our church. That's what people are doing. Folks, I'm learning something. At the end of the day, all other things will die with the end of time. The things that will last forever are things that you do for Jesus and for your church, period. There's an old saying, the grasshopper on the fence makes more noise than the ox in the field. But it's the ox in the field that does all the work. The churches are filled with people that talk much. Talk. And yet they do little for God. There are a lot of people in churches that will talk the talk, but they won't walk the walk. Can I give you the meaning of willingness? I had someone to write this in on a sheet that we gave them when we were trying to nominate people for committees and jobs and stuff in the church. I've kept it. This person wrote, and I quote, listen to what she said. Any place that I can serve suits me. It doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be a big place. I'm willing to work anywhere in my church where I can glorify my Lord. That's number two. Let's go to number three. Our church can't do without people of vision. Vision. Look at Philippians 3. And verses 13 and 14, Paul talks about vision, but in two ways, and we'll get to that in just a moment. He said in verse 13 to the church at Philippi, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. And then, of course, in Proverbs, everybody knows that verse. Don't you know it? Anybody know it? Raise your hand if you know it. Without vision, the people will perish. Have you lost your vision for pathway? Paul talks about forgetting things in the past, looking forward to the things in the future. Is this what you're doing at your church? Have you lost your vision for your church? There is a church in a county west of here, no names, but it's a truth. There is a church west of here in a western county that met with the local director of missions. And there were seven people from that church that met with the director of missions. And they gave him the keys, all the deeds, lock, stock, and barrel. They closed their doors. A church that was over 100 years old. You know why that happened? They lost their vision. It got down to just a group of people. And it was all about them. It was all about them. It wasn't about the community. It was all about them. And they thought they could last forever. And what happened? One began to die. Two began to die. The money began to fail, you know, from coming in because different ones were dying that had been giving. All of a sudden, they got down to those last seven people. They couldn't do it anymore, couldn't even pay the utilities. Once your vision is gone, pathway, it's a matter of time. You hear me? It's like a person with a terminal disease. It is a matter of time. When the doctor says, I've done everything I can do, I'm sorry, it's a matter of time. Pathway, it is a matter of time if you lose your vision. Number four. In Philippians 4:7, the fourth one is that the church can't do without its peacemakers. In Philippians 4:7, Paul said, in the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Look up at verse 2. He's encouraging two ladies in that church that were having some, issues, couldn't get along. And look what he says in verse 2. He says, please, be of the same mind. In other words, he was encouraging them to be peaceful and be at peace, these two ladies in verse 2. Number 4, we cannot do without peacemakers. Do you know what a peacemaker is? This is someone that arranges for peace. This is someone that settles an argument. This is someone that stops a fight. This is someone that says, hey, I'm sorry. It's someone that says, let's make it right. Can we make it right? It's someone that says, let's move on. It's not worth it. Let's move on. There are some churches today that would literally explode if it were not for their peacemakers. Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers. That's in Matthew 5. I've got it up there on the screen. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are the peacemakers. People are going to know that you belong to God. You show yourself and have a hissy fit and all this stuff and say things that you shouldn't say. I mean, that's not of God. Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. I'm going to ask you a blunt point to point, man to man question. Are you a peacemaker or a troublemaker? Number five, Philippians 4 and verse 8. Our church can't do without its boosters. You see that word boosters? You know what that word means? You know what that word means. Boosters. Our church can't do without its boosters. Paul said in verse 8, chapter 4, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. All organizations has boosters. Slocum, our kids are very much involved in the Slocum for all the sports because all our kids are playing ball at Slocum. So our sons and daughter-in-laws are all involved in the Slocum Red Top boosters, you know, trying to continually. It's an all-year situation trying to raise money. And there's some big boosters in Slocum. So we all know that there's organizations that has boosters, but churches has boosters too. When I started the church in New York and we started growing, I don't believe I've ever said this, but there was a time that I was scared to death because we were growing so fast. I thought, oh my, what am I going to do? I led to the Lord a man by the name of Larry Seracki. And I was able to lead Larry, Diane, and the children to the Lord and baptize every one of them. Larry was on fire for God. You know what Larry did in that city? He worked for the radio station. He was a salesperson in the radio station. And when he got saved and became a part of our church, Larry Seracki became our biggest booster. He would go and he'd tell people before he'd leave, he'd say, hey, do y'all go to church? Let me tell you about my church. And he would tell them about this church. And you got to come hear this guy from Alabama. You've got to come hear him. I mean, he was our biggest booster. We grew a lot because of Larry Seracki being our biggest booster. There ought to be a sign right out there in front of that door, stuck right on the wall, that says, come in without knocking, go out the same way. I was right over here at this hospital, back before COVID, and I was on the floor, the heart floor, the big waiting room when they have heart surgery, and I was in that waiting room. It was slap full with people. There was a group of people right in the corner, and they were talking about their church. And if I were to tell you the church, you'd know who it is. They were talking about their church. And I thought, my word, the gall. I cannot believe these people are talking about their church this way in this waiting room. Oh, my word. I felt my face turn red. My blood pressure went up. I mean, I thought, oh, what am I going to do? I need to say something. This is horrible. And everybody in the waiting room were listening. And I finally had to get up and leave. I just had to leave. But I've thought about that. And I've thought about that in order to say what I'm about to say. Pathway, boost it or lose it. Every church needs to hear that. Boost it or lose it. I'll close with number 6. Our church can't do without giving people. Philippians 4 and verses 15. We have in these scriptures about the Apostle Paul thanking the Philippian church for giving to him. In verse 15, he says, "Now ye Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but you." You're the only one. Do you see that in verse 15? They gave to the Apostle Paul. And he talks about it in verse 16. All the way through these verses, he talks about this church being a giving church. Our church can't do without giving people. What is a giving person? Well, it could be someone that gives $100 a week. It could be someone that gives $10 a week. You with me? You follow me? Why? What is a giving person? It could be somebody that gives $100 a week, somebody that gives $5 or $10 a week. Why? You can measure a person's giving by what they have left over. Brad Pitt gave $1 million, I think it's been about 10 years ago, to Haiti. And everybody bragged and talked about how wonderful he was. But the fact was, he had millions left over. I'm just saying, someone who gives $10 a week and has $5 left over may be the person that's really making the sacrifice. There's some truth to this. So what am I saying? I'm saying churches seem to do without rich people. Did you know that? I've been in this over 50 years. Churches seem to do okay without rich people. But churches cannot do without giving people. If everybody gave like you at Pathway, how much money would this church have? Would there be enough money to pay the bills, just say the utilities? If everyone gave like you, let's do the broad picture here. If everybody were just like you at Pathway, what kind of church would we have? I'm just plain old Teddy. But you know what I've been praying about this morning? I knew what I was going to say. I've been praying, God, would you please take what I'm going to say and just make it convicting? I mean, I can't do it. I mean, if I could, boy, if I could, we'd have revival every week. But I can't. I'm not the best preacher and the best pastor and so forth and all this stuff. I'm just simple me. But I've got up this morning and I've told the truth and nothing but the truth. And I pray right now that God will hit us between the eyes. If there were ever a time that we need to wake up, it's now. Our Father, I pray for your convicting spirit as I have prayed earlier. Lord, convict us, those of us that are playing around, messing around, just going through the motions. Oh, God. Please, God. I need you. I need you, Lord. Help me as I preach your word. Bless it. In Jesus' name, amen.